Singh, student manager, Balaji Institute of Management and Human Resource Development, feels honored in welcoming Mr. Kashi Viswanath, director and head group HR of IKYA Human Capital Solution Limited. I welcome you, sir. Sir is an engineering graduate in metallurgy with post-graduation in human resource from Tata Institute of Social Science, having exposure in handling human resource function in leadership positions for India, Middle East, and Asia Pacific markets. He also has teaching exposure, being a visiting faculty at a reputed institute in Bangalore. He specializes in leadership and talent development, coaching and mentoring, PCMM, cross-culture management, integration management in outsourcing, mergers and acquisition scenarios. He has an experience of about more than 18 years in various industries such as Symphony Telica as Director HR, Wipro as the Head of Talent Engagement and Development, HCL as Senior Management Trainee and Resource Manager, as Management Trainee in Sale, as an analyst in Bombay Natural History Society, and is currently associated with IKEA Human Capital Solution Limited as the Director and Head Group HR. I hereby would like to call upon Mr. Kashi Viswanath to enlighten us with his words of wisdom. The podium is all yours, sir.
So two things, for me this is actually like a cricket ground where it's been rain hit and all the people are actually waiting to know whether the match is going to start, stop, or should they go home. Yeah, and this is not just any ordinary ground, this is the Eden Gardens for me, because this is my fourth appearance in this Eden Gardens, and when I come over here, actually this makes one feel that this is a ground that one must play. So this is the situation I am in now. You have between me and lunch something that I'm going to speak of. So you have to encourage me by saying that, go on and play your innings. Yeah? Please do that. Thank you. So I'm going to try to make it as interesting as possible. Some of the topics that I wanted to cover are already covered in some form or the other by my earlier presenters. I will present to you what I think my version of some of those things are. Yeah, that's exactly what I'm going to do. But before I start, let me ask you, how many of you over here think you have done a great job of actually coming and joining an MBA course? How many of you think you've done a great job? Wonderful. So many of you. You've achieved something. How many of you think you have achieved something? Major achievement. How many of you think you have achieved something? Wonderful. Okay. This side of the crowd? Okay. Yeah, I'll always look towards this side of the crowd. Great. This is a small presentation. Just have a look at this. Jet Airways. Some years back, thought that they have achieved, just like all of you think over here, they have achieved. Jet Airways thought that they have achieved. What did they achieve? They changed their uniform from blue to yellow, and they thought they've really done a great job. Correct? Until Kingfisher, that time Kingfisher was a big name, Kingfisher came and put this hoarding just above them, just above them, and they said, We made them change, and both Kingfisher and Jet Airways were thinking that they have done a fabulous job. They have done a fabulous job, just like each one of you sitting in this podium or sitting in this huge auditorium are thinking you have done a great job, correct? Until a small guy, until a small guy put up another slide above it. You see what happens? Now, what's the moral of the story for each one of you? What's the moral of the story for each one of you? What's the moral of the story? The moral of the story for each one of you is that whilst you think you have done a fabulous job by coming and joining this course in this beautiful college, and you think you have achieved a major milestone in your life, please remember that there is a small guy just across the road somewhere, maybe in Pune or maybe in this country, who is trying that much harder than each one of you. because he wants to make it bigger in life than each one of you. And that's an important lesson I want to speak to you all about, because that's what I thought. I thought I have a pedigree, you see, NIT, Trichy, TISS, all of that. But then I find that when I enter into industries, there are people who probably may not have half the opportunities that I had who are actually leading organizations. And what's the difference between them and me is what my own introspection is, which I have converted into a small presentation, which I want to present to all of you. Why is it that some people who probably don't have the education like many of us over here in this room are actually doing very well for themselves in the industry? What is it that they have done? And that's what could be some of the thoughts that I want to share with all of you. One of the most important, and whilst I was listening to the other speakers, one of the points that came up is, we got technology today. The room which I was staying in a hotel was completely controlled by iPhone. I could control AC, TV, everything by iPhone. And that's the type of technology that each one of you have. I'll give you an example of what happened and how this technology was misused. We had a set of people like you who joined us this time as management trainees. They joined us. There were about 30 of them who joined us as management trainee, including a student from your own college, one student from your college. And they all came, and they were given a task as to prepare. They were given 2 days' time, and they were asked to prepare. They were given a few organizational challenges, and they were asked to go and prepare a slide on how would they overcome these organizational challenges. Some of it was around growth. Some of it was around new areas that the company should get into, and so on and so forth. You know how they spend the 2 days? How do you think they spend the 2 days? Most of the people in the 2 days were found in places Googling for results. Most of the people were found in spaces Googling for results. They wanted results, everything on the computer. And they got many, many innovative ideas through Google. But what they missed, and when they presented this across to the leadership team of my company, the leadership team asked them to shut their presentation and go off and come back again with a practical approach to what their solutions were. And they asked them to go back to their drawing boards and come back. What do you think was happening over here? And that's one of the most important messages that I must pass on to all of you. That message is that everything is not available in technology. For example, what Mr. Ramaswamy spoke in the morning for me would not be available in any Google search that I could get. What the earlier speakers probably spoke through their heart and through their wisdom could not be probably found through any of the Google searches that might be there. And therefore, it is important that you remain inquisitive. You remain, keep your mind open and inquisitive to speak to the people who actually are there around you, to get wisdom from them, to actually go and speak. If you're there in an organization, go and meet the employees of the organization and ask them what these issues are. That physical touch, which probably was there in a generation before you, needs to be there within you too. And that's an important message that I want to pass on, because not everything can be Googled. And whilst this Google subject remains, now the most important message to all of you is also that be humble. Humility is probably the most important quality that a leader today should have. It is important that you should be humble. It's important that you should learn from people around you. It's important that you should remember that there are others who know more than you. And that's an important message that I must pass on to you, because you are the fortunate ones. You are actually lucky over here to be studying and getting all some of these messages, most important things coming from people. But it's important that you be humble. Humility is something that is a key attribute of a leader. So please be with that. These are 2 points which I wanted to start my presentation with. Other than that, I have a few things, messages to pass on to all of you. Some of it is from my experience. For example, in my opinion, what it takes to be a successful leader or successful person today in industry, I'm not even going up to leadership. I'm saying to be successful in the industry that we work with. And I have put a few points, and these I call the 4 legs of the stool on which a professional actually sits today. For example, politically savvy. Emotional intelligence. Again, this point has come again from my side. I will explain in my way what I mean by this. It was spoken by my earlier speaker too, emotional intelligence, political savviness, executive presence. What is executive presence? Let me cover a bit about that. And the last one is managerial courage. The four which I have, I think, are very important are what I have placed over there. Now let me try to cover each one of them through my experience and the way I look at it. Maybe the definitions might not meet exactly what the definition is there theoretically, but let me try to cover what I think about these. First of all, political savvy. What do you think is political savvy? What is political savviness, according to some of you? Can I get a few answers, please? What is political savviness? What is political savviness? Anybody has an answer? Just one answer would just, anything that you think. What is political savviness? It has got two words, political and savvy. What do that mean? What does that mean? And this is something they don't teach in any college. Nobody can teach you to be politically savvy. Who can deal with people effectively? That's a very broad term, but yeah, probably yes. Who can deal with people effectively? Any other suggestion? Any other points? Any other thoughts from this side? Sorry? Diplomatic is diplomacy, or the art of diplomacy, okay? Let me give you an example of what happened to me. I spent about 11 years at Wipro, and after which I joined a UK-based organization called Cable and Wireless. I joined a UK-based organization called Cable and Wireless Worldwide. When I joined the organization, Cable and Wireless had gone through a worldwide restructuring, and they split into two organizations, and the entire leadership team that had hired me into that organization actually left, had left. So I was reporting to a completely new set of leadership team, completely new set of leadership team. I had come with a lot of ideas from Wipro to implement in this organization. I got into this organization and quickly tried to implement many of those. In that process, I could not understand the complex organizational dynamics that existed within the organization. My boss was based out of UK. He was a typical Britisher whose language would never mean that he actually tells you no. For example, he would say, "What do you think about this?" When a UK person says, "What do you think about this?" it means he wants you to do that. Or if he says, "Would you like to do this?" what he means is you have to do this, correct? Not that he's asking you. I could not understand this complex organizational metrics which was there. I could not understand the power system that existed within the organization. I couldn't understand the matrix structure that existed within the organization. I couldn't understand the dynamics that existed within the organization. And I miserably failed in that organization. I miserably failed. And I don't hesitate to say this because some of you would be, and God forbid, should be in such situations, because it is the reality of life. For example, you could have organizations where the family members are controlling certain portions of the organization. They are brought in a professional management. There could be so many such realities, which is important for you to understand. So being politically savvy is actually understanding the dynamics that exist within organizations. Understanding the dynamics that exist within the organization and use and channelize these dynamics to meet your end objectives. And I think that is the definition of political savvy, and ensure that whatever decisions that you would like to take, how would you channelize this? You don't have to, at the end of it, change your decisions. You don't have to change your objectives. But how do you channelize this through a complex maze that exists in organizations is something very important for all of you to understand. And this cannot come. This does not come on its own. It cannot be taught in books. Nobody can talk to you and tell you that this is how politics in the organizations would be there, or this is how you have to be politically savvy. It's something that you need to develop over a period as an individual, as a manager. And that can happen if you interact with more and more individuals. If you start interacting with more and more individuals, if you start looking at situations and analyzing situations which exist around you, you can possibly develop this particular skill. And this is a very important message I want to leave from being politically savvy. I come to the next area, again, a favorite area spoke by the earlier person about emotional intelligence. What is emotional intelligence? And this is my way of looking at emotional intelligence. Everybody expresses emotions. You express emotions, they express emotions, I express emotions. All of us express emotions. It is important for one human being to understand what is the emotions that is being expressed by the other human being. And if this understanding becomes very clear, And I, as an individual, am able to use the emotions expressed by the other person reasonably well. I become emotionally intelligent. In this process, there is something called where the shoe pinches. Where the shoe pinches. For example, if I were to work very closely with professor, or I want to work with Mr. Professors in Balaji Institute, I have to work with them, and I'm brought here as a consultant to work with them, it is important for me to know where the shoe is pinching for them. Because if I know where the shoe is pinching for them, the initiatives or whatever I want to bring in, I will bring in that direction. As you all enthusiastically enter into industries, you will be enthusiastic to implement a lot of ideas that you have learned in curriculum. But if those ideas are not in line with where the shoe is pinching for your managers in the organization, it will be a terrible disappointment for you. And that is where your emotional intelligence needs to come by, where you are able to understand by talking to the other person what is troubling him, what is really troubling him. And when you know what is really troubling him, your job as professionals is to remove that trouble away from him. And that is something that I sometimes feel I haven't done so well in my career so far. I have tried to bring in initiatives which I think are good, but not what the organization thinks are good to have. And that's a big, big gap. And that is something which I would like each one of you to look into. And that can happen only when you start interacting with people keeping that perspective in mind. And that is my way of looking at emotional intelligence. That's my way of looking at emotional intelligence, looking into where the shoe is pinching for the other person. If the shoe is pinching, if the person does not have a shoe, you can't give a suggestion where you give him a Reebok or Nike or so on and so forth. You have to give him something accordingly. So that's where, find out where the shoe is pinching. The third is what very important area which I call as executive presence. What is executive presence, according to some of you? What is executive presence? What is executive presence? An executive presence, maybe not in my definition, but maybe coming out with a solution. But what is executive presence? Is wearing a suit, yes, sorry? Dedication towards work is executive presence. Okay, one way to look at it. Is wearing a snazzy two-piece, a three-piece suit executive presence? Will you say a person who is very nattily dressed, superb dress sense, does he have executive presence? Yeah, could be. An element of your personality. So what is it that you as students can do to improve, develop this personality aspect? What is it that you could do? For example, let me ask you, and I keep asking this question in many of the interviews, very important. How many of you are from Lucknow? Over here, just a show of hand. There could be somebody from Lucknow, correct? So in one of the interviews, I had a person who said, I am from Lucknow, you know? And then I asked that person, that if you are from Lucknow, how did the name Lucknow come into existence? How many years you have been staying in Lucknow, I asked. The person said, 5-6 years I've been staying. Then I asked, how, or from life, from birth, I'm staying in Lucknow. Why is it called Lucknow? And then the person was blinking. No idea, no clue. What is famous in Lucknow? Tunde kebab. Have you heard of tunde kebab? How did the name tunde come into existence? Again, blink. Now, what I'm trying to say over here is not that you should be good quiz masters. No, that's not what I meant. The idea is you should know the surrounding in which you live minimum. And you should have an idea about a variety of topics which is there. How many of you have hobbies over here? How many have hobbies? Okay. How many are very serious about their hobbies? Okay. Let me tell you an example of one instance which I faced. A person from project manager from UK came and met me in India, and he told me that his hobby was astronomy. I said, wonderful. I also love astronomy. And I told him, you can go and visit this planetarium, that planetarium, all of that. So he laughed, and he just left at that. Then I asked my other colleague, why did he laugh? So then I came to know that this gentleman is actually an astronomer to such a reputation that NASA actually sent him to Egypt to observe the movement of the solar eclipse, you know, and map it and do some activity around that. His expertise is solar flares. Solar flares is his expertise level. And he calls it a hobby. The point I'm trying to drive over here is not that you must have a hobby and get so depth into it, but as business people, if you have to develop executive presence, you need to have knowledge about little bit about everything that's happening around you, where you can have a conversation with someone at least for 5 to 6 minutes on a topic which might not be really a topic where you are really deeply interested in. For example, if someone says, I'm from Lucknow, you should be able to talk to him for 5 minutes and say, hey, Lucknow, this is the way Lucknow is, and speak for 5 minutes. Or if someone says, I love cricket, you should be able to talk to him about cricket for 5 minutes or so. Or if someone says that I love some other thing, for example, cooking, you must be able to talk to him on the different types of cooking at least for 5 minutes. You can't be blinking over there and saying, this, I don't know this topic. That's, in my observation, executive presence. And how can that happen? That can happen when each one of you read around, when each one of you interact with other friends around you and interact with an objective that you want to get some information from that person. Information about whatever is happening. For example, Mr. Ramaswamy from Roots spoke about, you know, some of the horns and things like that. Some of you who would have been keen would have captured a few points from him, and tomorrow if something comes up for 2 minutes, you can talk on horns and the type of horns that today cars are actually getting into and things like that. That is, in my opinion, executive presence. And that can happen in a beautiful institute like this, where you have friends and colleagues with whom you can share a lot of ideas and you can get a lot of points from them about various areas which are there. And that you must never lose. Because if you are able to do that, you will stand in a good executive conversation with anyone. And that, in my observation, is executive presence. Apart from, of course, personality, apart from dress and other things, that forms an important part of executive presence. And the last area which I wanted to cover is managerial courage. What is managerial courage? What is managerial courage? It has got two words. It's got manager and it's got courage. What is managerial courage? Yes? Okay. That's a good way of putting it. Yeah, you may not win, but trying to, yes. Thank you. Any other points? Yes? Decision-making ability, and especially, yeah, that's a wonderful point. That's exactly the point I wanted to bring up. Decision-making ability, when you know that your decision might not be favorable to your circumstances. A decision-making ability which might prove, you know, something which is not what you, which may not be beneficial to you, but still you stand to that decision. You stand up to that decision and say, yes, I will take this decision. That is managerial courage. How many of you have seen the movie Scent of a Woman? Have you seen this movie? Have you seen the famous scene in the court at the end? I'm going to play that scene just across to you. You know, it's a beautiful scene, Scent of a Woman. All of you are a little patient to hear that? 2 minutes. Yeah, this is a famous scene where there is a boy who is being, he is from the college and he has refused to change his statement against his friends. If he will accept the statement what the college wants him to take, the college will permit him to continue his studies. If he does not, then he has to leave the college. Such is his predicament at this moment. But yet, he stands by the decision that he wants to take. He knows the outcome of this decision is not favorable to him, but he still stands by the decision. And I'm going to show you that movie to just highlight what managerial courage is all about. But just hold on for some time, because I'm going to cover my last point, which I wanted to mention is about this. Who is this person and why is he so much in the news? Sorry? Who is he? CEO of? Okay, he may be CEO of whatever, but why is he in the news? Why did he leave his job? He left his job because his daughter gave him, and absolutely correct, all of you are well read, looks like. He left his job because his daughter gave him a list of 26 items, I think. You know, 22 items telling him what he has not done. You know, and that is why he was so guilty, he decided to leave his job. The point I'm wishing to drive over here, which my earlier speakers also drove, is that family and personal support is extremely critical. So whenever you are in a situation, you know, prioritize towards that. And that is very, very important. You should not be in a situation like him, where he suddenly felt so guilty that he had to leave. That's the last message that is there from this particular slide. But here is a small video about scent of a woman. So just enjoy this video before lunch.
I am left with no real witness. Mr. Willis's testimony is not only vague, it is unsubstantiated. The substance I was looking for, Mr. Sims, was to come from you.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry too, Mr. Sims. Because you know what I'm going to do, in as much as I can't punish Mr. Havemeyer, Mr. Potter, or Mr. Jameson, and I won't punish Mr. Willis. He's the only party to this incident who is still worthy of calling himself a BIMHRD man. I'm going to recommend to the disciplinary committee that you be expelled, Mr. Sims. You are a cover-up artist and you are a liar.
But not a snitch!
Excuse me?
No, I don't think I will.
Mr. Slade.
This is such a crock of shit!
Please watch your language, Mr. Slade. You are in the BIMHRD school, not a barracks. Mr. Sims, I will give you one final opportunity to speak up.
Mr. Sims doesn't want it. He doesn't need to be labeled still worthy of being a BIMHRD man. What the hell is that? What is your motto here? Boys, inform on your classmates. Save your hide. Anything short of that, we're going to burn you at the stake? Well, gentlemen, when the shit hits the fan, some guys run and some guys stay. Here's Charlie facing the fire, and there's George hiding in Big Daddy's pocket. And what are you doing? You're gonna reward George and destroy Charlie.
Are you finished, Mr. Slade?
No, I'm just getting warmed up. I don't know who went to this place. William Howard Taft, William Jennings Bryan, William Tell, whoever. Their spirit is dead, if they ever had one. It's gone. You're building a rat ship here. A vessel for seagoing snitches. And if you think you're preparing these minnows for manhood, you better think again. Because I say you are killing the very spirit this institution proclaims it instills. What a sham. What kind of a show are you guys putting on here today? I mean, the only class in this act is sitting next to me, and I'm here to tell you, this boy's soul is intact. It's non-negotiable. You know how I know? Someone here, and I'm not going to say who, offered to buy it. Only Charlie here wasn't selling.
Sir, you're out of order.
Out of order? I show you out of order. You don't know what out of order is, Mr. Trask. I'd show you, but I'm too old. I'm too tired. I'm too fucking blind. If I were the man I was 5 years ago, I'd take a flamethrower to this place. Out of order. Who the hell do you think you're talking to? I've been around, you know. There was a time I could see. And I have seen. Boys like these, younger than these, their arms torn out, their legs ripped off. But there is nothing like the sight of an amputated spirit. There is no prosthetic for that. You think you're merely sending this splendid foot soldier back home to Argonne with his tail between his legs, but I say you are executing his soul! And why? Because he's not a BIMHRD man. BIMHRD man. You hurt this boy, you're gonna be BIMHRD bums, the lot of you. And Harry, Jimmy, Trent, wherever you are out there, fuck you too!
Stand down, Mr. Slade.
I'm not...
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a wonderful, interesting movie, but the key over here is, you know, about your soul. So that's what he says, never let your soul be sold. So that's the key message. that's a little bit about managerial courage from the way I look at it. These are a few points that I just thought I must share with you, being politically savvy, ensuring you have executive presence, you know, ensuring that you have what is called as managerial courage, which is there, and ensuring, you know, some of these points is what I just wanted to share with all of you. Yeah, I'm open for questions now. I know it's getting a little delayed. Any questions from anyone, I'll be happy to answer. Please feel free to ask any questions if you have. We'll be happy to answer those.